So when I came, anyway, we drove to Montreal with Sam Greer, Shivananda's green Volkswagen bus, which he was very attached to. He was like an outdoor fisher guy, you know. Nice. Yeah. He kept saying, now, you know, he was really worried. I'm not going to come back with the bus, so something will happen. He said, you know, you really be careful. Okay, all right. Anyway, when we came to 26 Second Avenue, Kirtananda took us upstairs, me and Himavati. And we opened the door to his little room. And he looked up and he said, oh, you've come. Anyway, then I sat down, like you're sitting there, Prabhupada's over there, a little more close. And I was sitting, you know, just opposite. He's sitting against the wall behind his metal box. And I was so nervous. After I make obeisances, oh, this is what happened. Yeah, I come in. And I'm standing in front of Prabhupada, and all my limbs gave way. Like when you take a hit of LSD, you just kind of like become jellified, you know, that there's that sensation. So I kind of collapsed on the floor and made obeisances. Then I sat back and I was looking directly at Prabhupada, and he started to say how the karmis, they like all nasty things like coffee, cigarettes and tea. And we like all, I remember this line. So I'm looking at Prabhupada and he starts to streaming, like when you sometimes, when you're looking towards some bright thing, there's too much light. Anyway, so I squinted, I thought that's like, because I'm staring. So, no, but then I'm looking and it's more and more, and Prabhupada becomes his whole being. Becomes like golden, shining golden, like molten gold. Then I thought, I turned my head and, you know, blinked and turned this way. And I'm seeing Prabhupada like this, and it's just going on. And this happened practically every time I would see Prabhupada in another circumstance and had the opportunity of just really uninterruptedly seeing him. So it wasn't my imagination, it was really something happening. At any rate.
What did you think?
I didn't think, I couldn't, what could I think of? You know, seeing this, I was just... And before we left, I went to Prabhupada, the Swami. I said, oh, Swamiji, you know, I'm married, and so what should I do as a service? What is it that I should do? He said, I have 100 children for Krishna. I thought, oh my goodness. So on the way back, that child was conceived. It was born still later. You know, later it was born still. And that was foretold. Before I even met or became a devotee, we visited a friend. Her mother came. She was psychic lady. She was a little famous sort of. As a child, she saw the Hindenburg burn up, and you know, in a psychic vision. Anyway, so when we came to visit this girl, she was an artist like we were, and we walked in. As soon as that lady saw Himavati, she said, your first child will be stillborn. And I never forgot that. So the night we went to the hospital, I went to the hospital, and my body was in the delivery room. And I was remembering that. And then in those days you couldn't go in the delivery room. Now you can, I think you can. But anyway, at one point I saw the doctors and the nurses, they come out and they were kind of in a huddle, and I could understand from their facial and everything. So they came outside, and I said, "It's okay, I understand, I know." And then the next day, I don't know, the next day or the day after, next day I think, Prabhupada announced he's going to install the Jagannath deities. I think I told
you. Yeah.
Yeah, okay, so that's there. But I asked Prabhupada, why did that happen? That, why is the child still born? He said the child only had a little more time to do. So he went back. That's what he said. So, anyway, that was my first Krishna. I think after that we went to Boston to... No, I think we went back to Montreal. Wait a minute. What am I talking about? When she gave birth. Okay. No, then we went back to Montreal after that. Because we opened Boston somewhere in between. Mm-hmm. She was pregnant at the time we were in Boston. Anyway, Krishna, what else do you want to know?
From Germany, you went to India, because we saw the movies. You were in India with Prabhupada, when Prabhupada introduced Dancing White Elephants.
Yeah,
you were
that
there
was,
at that time, right?
Yeah, that was 19... I think it was 70, right?
Or
was
70,
it 71?
Yeah.
I can't remember.
70?
70. Yeah. Yeah, we were always hosted by some... aristocratic or wealthy family. We were hosted by the Bajaj family. They make the motor scooters. And we were at Vino Bobby's ashram. He was like the right-hand man to Gandhi. Bhagubhai Jariwala, he was the biggest jari maker in Surat. Yeah, I think there are a lot of videos of that.
Yeah.
And we went to Kumbh Mela also. Kumbh Mela. So Kumbh Mela was we were a sensation, right? White people, Kumbh Mela. And there's a particular astrological time period or window where if you take a bath, it's said you're guaranteed you're going to be liberated. So we, myself, Himavati, Madhavisa, Tamal, we would go early in the morning. You had to go like 3:30, something like that, and immerse yourself and chant the Gayatri Mantra. So, and it was pitch black, there were no lights, nothing. The wind is blowing around. It was, I think, February, I think. So I asked Prabhupada, I just wanted to make sure. I said, "Prabhupada, is it true that if you take the bath on this particular time, I think you had to do it 1 week long, or 2 weeks, I can't remember." He said, yes, it's guaranteed you're liberated. He said, "But we didn't come here for that. We're already liberated." He said, "We came here to preach." But I went anyway. I wanted to have an insurance policy. So, that was a very, very sensational. All through that, it was about 10-month period, I think, that we traveled. Mm-hmm. And he sent me, Giriraj, myself, Giriraj, Himavati. He sent us on traveling Sankirtan, right? And of course, we don't know anybody, we don't know anything. But I remember Prabhupada, because I asked them, because we didn't have any money, nothing. He said, "Just keep chanting Hare Krishna, Krishna will provide everything." So we wound up in Agra at one point, in a Vitalnath temple. In the top floor they gave us a room in Agra. Agra. And Himavati got typhoid fever. And I didn't know that, but she was just like deathly sick, hallucinating everything. So at first I tried, calling in the doctor and this and that, and nothing worked. At that time I had met a man who turned me on to the Eretz Mucosless Diet Healing System. It was one of those things, which kind of focused on eliminating foods that cause mucus, like white bread, sugar, and so on, and eat fruit, which I did. And I mean, the man told me, he said, because I had terrible sinus problems, and one of the things I didn't know is that I would sleep with rose garlands, you know, but I didn't realize I was allergic to roses. So in the morning I'd wake up, my face, my eyes, my nose, everything. So I met this man, he said, if you follow this diet, in 3 days this will be disappear, never come back, as long as you stick to the diet. He gave me a little book, which I did, and sure enough, yeah. Anyway, but while I was doing this, Himavati got this typhoid. And no one, doctors came and went, couldn't do anything. Finally, I decided, hey, you got to follow this mucusless diet healing system. Right? And I locked the door, and that was it. And, you know, people pounding on the door, she's going to die, and so forth and so on. And even Himavati, she said, you know, this is, you know. I said, no, this is going to work, believe me. And sure enough, after about, I don't know, 7 days, on Lord Chaitanya's appearance day, the fever broke and she was okay. So anyway, I learned from that that it's a fact. If you just keep chanting, everything will come. Whatever it is you need, it'll come. Nothing to worry about. So we were, Giriraj was with us. Giriraj, he was also, he became a devotee in Boston early on. Nice devotee. Anyway, there, then Martin. And that was some of our first preaching movements. In those days, they had the communist influence. They called them Naxalites. They were blowing things up and so forth and so on. So sometimes we went to a program, and they'd be there. And one time in particular, they surrounded the car. You know, hundreds of them. They started rocking it. I'm going to flip it over. And we're in the car with Prabhupada. Himavati fainted. She just like. But we survived, you know.
And the German yatra was going on. You trained the people there, and
yeah, the German yatra was going on, and I left. I think Krishnadas in charge. Krishnadas. He was a young boy from San Francisco studying. He was studying jewelry making, and I'm not sure if I got the years right, but I think that was the year that Prabhupada flew to Moscow. Am I right? To meet Professor Kotovsky.
I was 71.
Okay, 71. So I was there. We had come to Visakhapatnam. Puri Maharaj had invited Prabhupada to open his temple, right? Mm-hmm. A great honor. And Prabhupada was supposed to go to Moscow at the end of this program. And I was supposed to go with him because I was the secretary and in some ways helped set that up. And I was really looking forward to that. So,
Why were you looking forward to it?
It just seemed like a far-out thing to go to Russia with Prabhupada. And nothing spiritual, you know, just me having some sense gratification, I guess. Anyway, it seemed like an extraordinary thing. But also I wondered, why would Prabhupada fly all the way to Moscow, spend a handful of money to see somebody just for a few days? It just didn't. Of course, now I know, wherever Prabhupada touched down, you know, the fire of Krishna consciousness expanded inexplicably. So, but this is what happened. So, I'm the secretary, so the secretary's business is, I don't know if you know the routine, the letters come in, the secretary opens all the letters and he reads them and underlines the points.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah,
and then he just passes those points to Prabhupada.
Yeah.
And Prabhupada makes some comment, and then you have to fill out a letter. So in comes a letter, and in the letter Krishna Das explained that he had left and gone to Sweden with this girl. And anyway, you know, he fell into Maya. Mm. So Prabhupada looked at me, he said, "You have to go back." Anyway, so from that, when Prabhupada went and took Shyam Sundar instead.
Mm-hmm. But when you didn't even show him the letter, he knew it was inside, right?
Yeah, he did. He for some reason, you know, he was looking at the envelope, you know, and he was just turning it over. And he said something to the effect that, "I think Krishna Das or he fell into Maya." Open the letter, and sure enough, of course. So, you know, I had to go back. So I decided to go overland because that, at that time that was my zone, Pakistan and Iran and all these countries, including Africa. So we traveled overland back to Germany.
Wow.
And that was really trying because the temple was, you know, they hadn't paid the rent in I don't know how many months. And
in Germany?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
It was just, it was almost like it had stood still from the day I left.
Mm-hmm.
And I was really depressed, really depressed. I would go every day and meet the postman, you know, walk 3 or 4 blocks down the road before he came to our place and ask if there was any mail for me. Because when Prabhupada wrote, it was in these aerograms, you know, so it was very easy to spot in this thing. So, and if nothing came, I'd just go back to the temple, go to sleep. And Himavati was running the temple. I just absolutely couldn't get myself to go through the routine of trying to get it all back together. It was difficult enough to get it going to begin with, right? But then one day, I don't know what got into me, I just decided, no, I'm going to do this, even if I have to spend the rest of my life here, I'm going to do this. And then from that point on, I went forward. Hmm. So, Krishna.
Was that the time when you went through Afghanistan and all that?
Yeah, we went through Afghanistan, Iran, Turkey. And I think Sarva opened a place, I think it was Sarva, he opened a place in Istanbul. We opened the center in Afghanistan, yeah. School for children, small. But, you know, later the government came and closed it down. So, what else?
Okay, well, there's some letters here. Okay.
Yeah.
This is from 1974.
Yeah, letter.
October.
Okay. Okay.
Prabhupada said,
I'm going to leave. This is a different set, but done by she knows because she used to has read them. She can. I just leave them, and you know, as long as you're here. But then I have to take all that back.
Okay.
Oh, here's one. And before we go any further, oh, here's one more book goes with this set. And this is. And this, are you familiar with this book here?
It sounds familiar.
It's a Russian manuscript was discovered in Russia at the turn of the century. And what's interesting about this book, that it's very simple. A Russian monk, he's traveling, and he's trying to, he meets different kinds of, they're called starets, like holy people or priests, and he wants to know how to get saved. You know, what do I have to do? And no one really knows how to answer this question, except, and this is basically the conclusion of the book. And it's very, why is it so interesting? Because it completely corresponds with chanting the holy name, but in a Christian, you know, but on principle, on Siddhanta, right? It's the same thing. So I thought that might interest you.
Okay, so I'll look it up.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, here's from Madhavananda. I have heard that there is some worship of yourself by the other devotees. Of course, it is proper to offer obeisances to a Vaishnava, but not in the presence of the spiritual master. After the departure of the spiritual master, it will come to that stage, but now wait, otherwise it will create factions.
Yeah, I remember that, yeah.
And then Prabhupada refers to it on the in the conversation from 1977. Well, I'm not sure if it's connected, but it seems to be...
Well, what happened was that this is what happened. I had a, you know, I was a kirtan guy, so when Prabhupada sent me to Bhaktivedanta Manor, London, basically, to take it over because it was going bankrupt, so there were some factions, very strong, you know, under Shyamasundar, Ribadinanda, and Madhavananda. And they would... kind of exaggerate, make a kind of a false, like false news, fake news. Anyway, when we had kirtan, it was done in such a way I was generally in the middle, right? And that's basically what it amounted to. So they reported that they were worshiping me, but it's not really a fact. It's more like. Just like Shyamasundar told Prabhupada, I'd sent the devotees to work in a cigarette factory.
Mm-hmm.
Not a fact, but, you know, things like that sometimes happen. So when they got clarified, everything was all right. Suddenly I closed the Edinburgh Temple because I didn't have a single person that knew what to do. But I didn't close it just to close it. I closed it to take them to London and train them up and then send them back and do the right thing. So when Prabhupada got the, you know, complete information, then everything was adjusted.
Okay.
I mean, that's, you know, what can I say?
All right, that clarifies a lot. All right, so I'm just gonna come back to the Ritvik appointment.
The letter.
The letter, yeah. What when you got the letter, how did you understand the order, the Ritvik system? Is it gonna last even after Prabhupada departs? What does it mean to be Ritvik?
Well, at that time it would have been hard for me to, because I didn't come to Vrindavan until October, where the others were already there and had all kinds of conversations.
Mm-hmm.
But to me, it was like this was going to be the arrangement. And when I came to Vrindavan and saw Prabhupada, as soon as I saw him, I understood that Prabhupada has made up his mind, he's going to go. That was my, you know, impression.
Mm-hmm.
It's like you come to visit a friend, you see the suitcases are packed and everything's like, you know, you realize, oh, this person's going to go on a trip.
Mm-hmm.
It's clear, right?
Yeah.
So it was like that for me. And as I said, you know, I had this epiphany on top of that some of the experienced disciples, they stay with the spiritual master in the last days. So, you know, I was waffling over this until that came to my mind, then I reread it and I thought, but these are the last days, even if Prabhupada stays another 20 years, these are the last days. So I just decided to put that out of my mind, you know, I'm just going to stay here. Well, however long it takes, didn't really matter. So that was very kind of, it was important for me.
Mm-hmm.
It was important. I stayed with Bhardraj in the guest house. I didn't stay with Tamal and the other, you know, people.
Okay.
In the guest house. And my function was really, I was singing for Prabhupada. Most of the time, I was alone with Prabhupada singing. Yeah, one or two people come. But Prabhupada actually made a remark at some point. He said, he asked sometimes, where are the others? He said, and then he made a comment. He said, when we're talking of management and business, they come. But when I'm chanting, that they go.
Yeah, he also said that they wanted to stay in their zones.
Yeah, that was my impression. I remember Kirtananda, as soon as there was one day where they approached Prabhupada to appeal, that Prabhupada should appeal to Krishna to let him stay some more because he's a pure devotee and anything the pure devotee asks, Krishna will grant. So Prabhupada said, okay. And then the next day, you know, they flew off. I mean, I know Kirtananda did that thing, maybe Satrupa too, I don't know. But that was the general, you know, feeling. At some point, there was an incident where Bhavananda was suggesting to Prabhupada, the Kaviraj said that if you take milk 12 times a day, that you'll gain strength. And Prabhupada said, no. Then so he repeated that, don't you think it's, you know, if the Kaviraj says that you get that you should try it? Prabhupada said, no. I mean, very abrupt, no. And then again he tried, and then Prabhupada finally said, why can't you let me die in peace? Another time, and similar, I think the same time, in that same framework and time and back and forth, Jayapataka came in, and or he was there, and he said, you know, he has a way of kind of almost shouting, oh, Prabhupada, you know, don't you think if the current, we've all come here to, you know, serve you, so I can't remember the exact words. And Prabhupada remarked, yes, even when you're here, you're not here. You know, so, yeah. There were other things, you know, that there was this whole thing they wanted, that Prabhupada wanted to go on Prakram, and Tamal was determined to convince Prabhupada it's not shouldn't do that, and you know. So you know, in one sense, I always felt like the oddball.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was an instance when you say that if Prabhupada says he's going to be cured by going on parikram, that we should do it.
Yeah, that was more important, the Kaviraj or Prabhupada.
Yeah.
And to Tamal, I said, you know, because he kept trying to paint me out like I was callous, I didn't care, I wanted to kill Prabhupada. I said, Tamal, why are you talking like that? Our business, we're just disciples. We do what the spiritual master says. And I quoted this famous, ours is not to wonder why, ours is but to do or die. So if Prabhupada says he wants to go on Prakram, we should arrange for that. That's all. And there was a point where Prabhupada actually called us all in and he wanted to take a vote. How many people think, do you know this?
No.
Oh yeah, there was, called us all in and he said, how many people think that I should, I can't remember if you used the word allowed or should not go on Parikram. I think it was allowed, but he said, you know, he wanted to know how many people think that I should not go or be allowed to go on Parikram. And everybody raised their hand. Except me. And then he asked, how many people think that I should be allowed to go? So I raised my hand, and Giriraj raised his hand. But when he saw that we were the only two, he took his hand down. I don't know, you know. It's just... And then I felt, of course, I felt like, wow, did I am I thinking wrong? Is something wrong with me? How is it possible that I'm... Anyway.
It's interesting because Prabhupada is not controlled by the material laws.
Yeah.
He's liberated.
Yeah.
So if one thinks that he can save Prabhupada, it's a material concept.
Yeah, you can say, you know, later on, Tamal wrote a little book, the last, I don't know, like a little drama.
Yeah, yeah.
About Prabhupada's disappearing. And in that book, when I saw it, I got actually very disturbed. He painted me out like I was, you know, some kind of a heartless, cruel. But that wasn't, I simply understood, it's like being a military guy. The general says, do this, you do it. You can suggest, but you have to ask. Can I make a suggestion? But you can't just, you know, go on. I mean, Tamal actually went out of his way to bring in Krishnadas, Babaji, and other Gaudiyas to, you know, basically to convince Prabhupada he shouldn't go on program. I mean, I thought it was absurd. You would say, Prabhupada, do you realize how bumpy the road is? Like, Prabhupada doesn't know how bumpy the road is. He's born in, right? He doesn't know. He knows. He himself was a dealer in pharmaceuticals. He had friends. Dr. Ghosh was his friend, a doctor. And I don't know. I just assume Prabhupada knows what he's doing. That's all. You know, if he wants to go, that's... we arranged for it. So Tamal actually thwarted that because Prabhupada asked me and Lokanath Swami to take charge of that and get a bullock cart. And so when I would ask Tamal for, you know, we need some money. I don't have anything. I came from Sri Lanka with nobody and nothing. So, you know, he said, well, you're the one that wants to take Prabhupada on parikram. And I said, Tamal, it's not like I want to take Prabhupada on parikram. Prabhupada wants to go, and he asked us to make arrangements, so that's all. And I need your cooperation. Without your cooperation, what can I do? So after that incident, I was really kind of disturbed, I have to say, and with Tamal, who's, you know, I told you, we were very, very, you know, close. And I remember being really, you know... And so one morning, we were chanting our rounds, going around the temple, and I just came face to face with him inadvertently. And I thought, well, I might as well get it off my chest. So I said, Tamal, you know, you did the wrong thing. And he, you know, I said, no. I said, you did the wrong thing, and you're going to pay for that. You did the wrong thing, you shouldn't have done that. And that, I don't know if that's the last time I talked to him, or I can't remember. Anyway, you know, whatever. And his point was everyone, I remember talking to him about his little book. He said, well, it's just a way that every disciple has their own way of showing their love for the spiritual master. I said to him, oh, that's presumptuous. We don't have any love for the spiritual master. We just do what he says, that's all. I said, I just do what he says. That's all I know. I don't know anything else. And, you know, I kind of left it at that. But I don't know. Krishna, Hare Krishna.
So when Prabhupada left, what happened? How do you remember?
Well, there's a routine that, you know, the spiritual master, was Bhavananda, Tamal, and can't remember who else. They bathe him, put new clothing. Then he's taken to the Vyasasan. And then there's kirtan all night. I remember Narayan sang, Yeh Nilo Prima Dana, a famous kind of. And I have to say, ever since I heard that, I always liked singing that song, Yeah, Nilo Prima Dana, very soulful. Anyway, Krishnadas Babaji was there, but, you know, most of the devotees kind of spaced out and fell asleep at some point. You know, it's all night. But Krishnadas Babaji, he was up all night singing. Narayan was there. I don't know if he was there all night. And then the next morning, there's a parade, and Prabhupada's carried on a palanquin through the streets of Vrindavan.
Yeah, we saw that in the movie.
Yeah, and I was the last day of Prabhupada's presence. The Kaviraj said in the morning that Prabhupada would probably leave his body at 6:30, something like that. So that day I sang, sitting on Prabhupada's bed, I was actually sitting on his bed, and I sang till about 6 in the evening. But I had to pass urine so, you know, badly. I'm a frequent urine guy, so 6 hours for me is... So I asked Bardraj to sing. I said, I'm going to run upstairs real quick. So I quickly ran upstairs. And I thought, you know, it could be a long night. Kaviraj could be wrong. And so, to refresh, I quickly jumped, took a cold shower, put on my dog, come back out. As I came down, I saw all the devotees were, you know, scattered like billiard balls. When you're, phew. Then I could understand that Prabhupada had departed. So from the window, if this is a window here on the outside and the domes of the temple. Oh, have you been in Vrindavan? Okay, so you're looking. I could look straight in. Prabhupada's sister was weeping and rubbing his chest all over him. And they started the process to give him a bathe him and dress him. Then the next morning, they put him in the samadhi. A deep hole, had to be 6 feet or more deep. And they sit Prabhupada down, and then they pack salt from head to toe. There's probably video right
now. Yeah, everything, yeah.
Yeah, and, well, that's Krishna, Hare Krishna.
What about the devotees that were devastated, I assume?
You know, I can't even remember what I did afterwards. I know that I did not participate in, except for a token, put some dirt, and then I stood far a distance to see everything from a distance, from a distant spot. I mean, in the compound, of course.
Mm-hmm.
Then later on, probably the next day, Tamal distributed the prasadam of Prabhupada, you know, different items. So I got a ring from Prabhupada. What is that ring? This ring.
Okay.
Wow. Red one, huh? Red one. Yeah. So that ring was made by Shyamsundar when Shyamsundar was in his ruby business. And so after I got this ring, that evening I had a dream. I had a dream of Prabhupada. And we were going on Parikram, myself and a few other devotees, we were going on Parikram right past the gate that faces Prabhupada's room or house. And in the dream I looked over and I saw Prabhupada standing in the doorway. I thought, that's funny, I thought Prabhupada left. I mean, it's a very vivid dream, Prabhupada left. So I paused, and he said, where are you going? I said, we're going on Parikram. He said, can I come? I said, yeah, of course. So he came, and we started walking. And at one point, he said, where is that ring? And I immediately knew that, you know, because I didn't have any other rings. I said, oh, I left it in my room. Prabhupada said, why? I said, well, when I play the drum, it cuts my finger. He said, oh. So he said, Shyam Sundar gave me that ring. I said, yes, Prabhupada, I know. He said, it's not finished very well. It's not very perfect, I think he said that. I said, it doesn't matter, Prabhupada, anything from you is perfect. Then we go a little further, then he stopped again. He said, you know, that ring is a ruby, and a ruby is meant for a king. That was the end of the dream. So I'm not trying to imply, I'm just saying this was a dream. I had many dreams of Prabhupada in Montreal, and especially when he was here. Krishna, Hare Krishna.
So when you got the letter, the July 9 letter,
yeah,
you knew that this is...
Yeah, I knew in a sense, you're asking the question in a different sense. I hadn't been to Vrindavan, you know, because I was involved with this Kabur thing.
Yeah.
And I was receiving regular letters from Tamal and also from Prabhupada. And Tamal was writing how Prabhupada is so excited every morning he wakes up, is any news from Sri Lanka and so forth and so on. So it was very exciting for me. And I didn't come until I think beginning of October. I can't remember the exact date. So receiving that letter was not exactly like it was for those who were in Vrindavan, because they have been having ongoing discussions. And obviously the pivot of their discussion or the main thesis or current was, you know, what about initiating after you're gone?
Yeah.
Right? So I never heard those. I think I didn't even hear them to this day exactly. Maybe just some snippets. I read some transcripts, but not exactly. So I didn't, you know, my thought process or my mindset was not like someone who had been throughout all that time with Prabhupada. But as I said, when I arrived there, as soon as I saw Prabhupada, it was just obvious to me that Prabhupada has made up his mind. He's going to go. And that was a sort of confirmed by him on different occasions, you know, by things he, responses that he had to devotees. So
the letter was, you understood that this was a permanent order?
Yeah. We understood it was a permanent order. Why? You know, some would say, how could you? Because Prabhupada would talk many things and sometimes project some plan. Right? But unless you received an order to that effect, you know, a letter, something written, it was a different thing, you know. The Prabhupada said you can say anything, but don't put in writing because that makes it legal. So, and that Prabhupada would make the comment about, say, Brahmananda, somebody said when you were formulating the list, that what about Brahmananda? And Prabhupada's response was, no, not unless he's fit. So there, it wasn't like some people today suggest. These were just, you know, random functionary choices. No, it wasn't like that. It was, these were the people that Prabhupada wanted or felt had, you know, performed the services that indicated they were capable people. You know, opening temples, printing books, so forth and so on.
So, now what happened in between this time and the Gorpanim 78, when, you know, there were 11 successor acharyas nominated or, you know, announced that they're gonna be the successors to Prabhupada, the Diksha Gurus.
What happened
is in
your
between
question. It's hard to say because I was Prabhupada left, and I had almost immediately the next day I had to go to Germany to pick up the legal the legal thread to that court case, which was a big deal. Mm-hmm. And Hari Kesh had, become prominent there. He was sent, in fact, I suggested he go there to Prabhupada when we were in Hyderabad, because I didn't think Jyotirtha really could do what had to be done there. And I was right. He was very good. He printed a lot of books. And I had come to know Hari Kesh for the first time in Hyderabad. We became very friendly also. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to actually go to America and join Tamal's party. I said, why do you want to do that? Why don't you go to Germany? Because they need somebody there. Jyotirtha can't do what has to be done, Sankirtan and all that. He's not that kind of person. So why not, I can suggest to Prabhupada to send you, then you'll have your own field and you don't have to contend with, anybody getting on your case. What do you say? He said, yes. So I suggested to Prabhupada, and Prabhupada agreed to send Hari Kesh there. Anyway, when I came there for that court case, Hari Kesh was so uptight, about my coming back, because all these devotees knew me, they knew me very directly, personally, and they liked me, and I liked them, and all of a sudden the situation, has changed drastically, and I'm going to come back. So he made it a point to tell me, don't come to the kirtans, don't give any lecture, don't even talk to these people, And he gave me a room at the very top, basically in the attic of that schloss, right, to make sure that I would not... He had it in his head that I was just going to initiate everybody and take them away. I said, I have no idea. I said, I'm glad to be out of here. I mean, I did my time here. This was a grueling, situation, which, have no desire to do anything like that. So don't worry. But he just didn't believe that. He was really paranoid. And I complied, I just stayed there. Then I went to the court case, which was sensational, by the way. You could make a whole movie about it. And then when it was done, I went to America. My zone was that Berkeley place, Berkeley. Which I didn't want. I tried to convince the GBC not to send me there. I said, Prabhupada said I shouldn't have anything to do with management or administration. I should just preach and have kirtan all over the world. And they took this to mean that, I'm trying to be, run all over and do my thing, right? Mm-hmm. Anyway, so I came to Berkeley, which was a nut house, a mess. They had the women's party and all kinds of problems, big problems.
And at this point, did you understand that you were a Ritvik or a full-fledged guru?
It that time wasn't yet, at least not for me. It wasn't, the problems in Berkeley were so enormous, so glaring, right? Mm-hmm.
Because I saw a picture, that's Gaur Panim, 1978, and there were these 11 Vyasasans.
Yeah.
And that, so far I'm concerned, that was like the official announcement that these guys are the gurus. And you're going to worship them as good as Prabhupada.
I think so. I think it was more gradual than that. It wasn't quite that like declaring World War II or something. It was a period where I think everyone, maybe I'm wrong, was deliberating over this or wrestling with it or exactly. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the reasons I say that, because at some point They went to Sridhar Maharaj.
Okay, yeah.
To consult him.
Yes.
Which means they weren't